I have a confession to make, okay? At King's, I lead the system security research lab, and we work at the intersection of program analysis and system program analysis and machine learning for system security. So we've been working a little bit at this intersection, and we've come to a conclusion that we might, as a community, have been using machine learning in security context erroneously, okay? This is a bit of a bold statement, I understand, probably a punchline, so let me just, you know, smooth it down a little bit for you, okay? So I love machine learning. So I believe that machine learning has been producing great successful results in a number of different tasks. You can think about image recognition, classification, speech recognitions, recommendation systems, anti-fraud detections, and so forth and so on. When we move into security context, we've been working and applying machine learning even back in the days where we didn't call it machine learning, really, for quite some time. And you can read papers that have been published continuously in top-tier conferences, that aims at classifying malware, clustering malware, and finding anomalies in network traffic and so forth and so on. And here, I'm not referring, of course, at adversarial poisoning or membership inferences attacks that undermine the security of ML systems. So these are open issues that we're still trying to find a solid solution to. But there is something that we are probably neglecting in our community. If you look at the papers that have been published, even recently, in top-tier conferences, you can see that there are tantalizing results with performances that boast 99% or F1 score or whatever score you're interested in. It could be precision or recall if you don't want to harmonize them together as F1 score. So the problem is that, well, the problem seems to be solved then, because with 99% F1 score, I would say that is a pretty good result. There are some implications, there are some assumptions that we tend to neglect because we're just borrowing best practices from the ML community to evaluate our machine learning systems. In particular, in security contexts, we often observe data in a non-stationary environment, which means the statistical property of the testing data set changes over time, and the assumptions of IID that usually ML algorithms require are violated, so we observe constant drift and performance decay over time, okay? So this is pretty all right, but we need to understand that there is this problem, and therefore, evaluating ML processes or ML tasks in this context, just by borrowing from the best practices and using, for instance, K-fold cross-validation, might not be the best solution. And I'll try to convince you why this might be not the best solution. So we see that performance decay over time, but the interesting point is also to understand, okay, how much do these biased evaluation that we incorporate in our approaches affect ML performances? And how can we perform a sound and realistic evaluation? Because once I know that there is a problem, then I would like probably to address the problem. And so what we identify is that there are temporal and spatial bias that are endemic in the evaluation of ML tasks in security context. And we therefore identify constraints that operates in the temporal and spatial domain that we should be enforcing to have a sound evaluation of such systems. And at the same time, we also propose a metric that is able to capture how quickly this performance decay happens over time, because that it will be interesting to understand, given that number, whether we can compare different strategies to slow down the performance decay. The problem is endemic, and it just affects every ML process in security where there is non-stationarity in the loop. Of course, to understand how badly performance decay affects a specific context, we will need specific data. And of course, you know, although this can be generalizable, it's hard to draw just generic conclusions just for this talk. So for the sake of the talk, I'm going to be focusing on a specific domain, which is Android security, Android classification. The sole reason is because now there is a very large data set that we can have access to that is available to everyone. And also there has been a lot of research, especially in academic communities and academic conferences, that have been proposed results and tantalizing results. And we're trying to understand, you know, what's going on there. So first things first, the data set. We take applications out of the Andrew Zhu dataset that is maintained by the University of Luxembourg, and we focused on roughly 130,000 Android applications, 10% of which are malware. And I will tell you later, later on during the talk why 10% and not another number. And we try to have a large-scale evaluation that is quite stable, so we consider 3 years of time from January 2014 to December 2016, and there are reasons why not we're including 2018, for instance, although, of course, you know, we could have included 2017, and we're working on just extending this evaluation. But still, 3 years worth of data, I believe, is quite reasonable to draw some interesting conclusions. And as you can see in the plot in the slide, basically, we tend to have a 10% of malware that is distributed roughly uniformly over the time span. And in this data set, we usually perform experiments by training on 1 year from 2014 and then testing on the two subsequent years. Of course, once we agree on the data set, we now have to understand, okay, what are the tasks that we want to evaluate? And it's hard, really, to draw conclusions and try to run empirical evaluation on all the approaches that have been published so far. So we tried in this work to select a couple of representative work that we believe are generic to the category. So we selected a couple of works that have been published in top-tier conferences, and they are employing different program analysis underneath to create the feature space that we need, and they're also employing different machine learning algorithms. So the idea is to try to see whether this is quite of a generic approach that we're trying to design rather than focusing on something that is specific. In particular, the first algorithm statically extract features from APK, from Android applications, and it's a very simple feature space that is a bit vector. So one, if the feature is present, for instance, an API call has been invoked, or zero if it is not present. And the underlying machine learning algorithm is just a linear SVM classifier. The second algorithm is a little bit more complex, has been published quite recently at NDSS, and it builds up the feature space with a static program analysis that builds Markov chains from static call graphs through flow analysis. So underlying, it uses FlowDroid if you are interested in the details. And the features are transitions matrices from the Markov chains that are built through the program analysis. And the classifier is just a random forest. Again, two different type of program analysis, one very lightweight, another one is a bit more complex, and two different type of machine learning algorithms. So let's have a look at the temporal bias and what I mean by temporal bias. So we borrow from the ML community best practices to evaluate our algorithms. And in general, it is well known that we should be evaluating our algorithms with a k-fold cross-validation or holdout validation. But let's focus on a k-fold cross-validation. And it looks like, you know, magical because the goal is to hinder to overfit the training data set, so the process, the model we learn, to a specific data set, to the training data set. And the idea here is that you take your data set, you partition data set in k-fold, you train on k-1, and you test on the kth fold, and you repeat this process k time, and you average the result. So the idea is that all the data set is used for training and testing, not at the same time, but eventually all of it is covered. And in this case, the idea is that you just hinder the risk of overfitting to a specific lucky case of training that you might have selected if you just randomly pick just one slice out of it. So what is magical might also turn into a curse of cross-validation in this context. Again, we're working in a non-stationarity context. The problem, what is the problem? So think about just taking your data set and roll it out on a timeline. You can think that if you're working in a k-fold cross-validation, you will eventually just select random you sample from your data set, k-1 fold, and test on the kth fold. So this means that you might train with data that is coming, that is in the future, and test in data that is from the past, although having data that actually mix each other, of course. But this is not representative of a realistic deployment of the classifier. So in a realistic deployment of the classifier, it would just train with whatever you have until a specific time t, and then from that point onward, you can test your object. Of course, you can retrain and stuff like that, but you don't mix it up future and past in the train because future is a knowledge that you don't have when you deploy the model. So if we want to enumerate a few other temporally inconsistent data set partitioning, I'll try to do this in the slides. So the first one is a K-fold cross-validation where you see a dark square wherever that slice is used for training and testing eventually all over the time frame. And the two different rows in the slide identifies goodware and malware. So we're focusing on a binary classification problem. And for simplicity, we're just looking at Android malware classification. So we have goodware and malware. So we might have another temporal inconsistent training if instead of using K-fold cross-validation, we just sample the data set and we extract for the training data set points that are in the future and we test against points that are in the past. Of course, also this one is a temporal inconsistent one because when we deploy the model, we cannot have this configuration. We can only train from things that happened from the past, so historic trail, up until a certain point T, and then we can test from that information onwards. So we might have also another temporal inconsistent configuration in which we are actually training and testing using the right time frame. So we trained using objects that are coming from the past, and we test with objects that are coming from the future. But if you look at the two classes, and if you look at the time frame in which you draw samples from these classes, they're actually from disjoint time frames. So if you look at the third row in the slide, you can see that, for instance, in this example, we trained a classifier with objects in the first two slices, the dark square that you can see there for malware in the training dataset, and we use objects that are far away in the future for benign. And then when we test, we comply with the fact that training objects must be anterior to testing objects, that's fine, but you can see that there is a disjoint in the time frame that we draw a sample from the testing, from the goodware and malware, which means that the classifier, we have no guarantees that the classifier is actually learning something that is useful for us. So maliciousness property, for instance. It might actually just pick up some artifact differences in APIs that are not representative of what we will actually observe once we deploy the model. So as simple as it is, if we want to actually avoid temporal bias in our evaluation, we just have to be sure that the training dataset is all anterior to the testing dataset, and that objects in the two classes that we are considering are drawn from the same time slice. As simple as that. Now, if you want to look at the effect of this time decay and of the proper evaluation, well, just have a look at this slide. And on x-axis, we have the testing period, so each tick is just 1 month. And on the y-axis, we have a score. And the lines represent F1, the blue one, recall the red, and yellow is the precision. And we can also see that there is a dashed red line at the top that represents the F1 score in a 10-fold cross-validation evaluation. So you can see that if you want to evaluate how good is an algorithm in this specific task, and you look at the K-fold cross-validation, well, you might say, well, in this case, it's 0.92, something like that. And you might just think that this is a good result, so that the algorithm is good and I can deploy the algorithm. But if you want to actually understand how quickly the performance decay over time, well, you have to look at the other lines, basically. So in this case, we train on the year that comes earlier, and then we test on these two other years that are shown in the plot. And you can see that there is a, so focus on the F1 score, the blue line. So you can see that there is a downwards trend. This is expected because, of course, we're in the presence of concept drift, and we expected the performance decay over time. But as you can see, this is far away from a 0.92 F1 score that K-fold cross-validation would actually show to us. And this is what you will obtain if you deploy the model, when you deploy the model. So to summarize, on the temporal scale, there are two constraints that we should be enforcing to have a sound evaluation of ML classifiers in a security context. The first one is that all the training objects must be temporally anterior to all testing objects, and this is actually not something that we just proposed ourselves at first. So also Miller et al. Proposed a few years ago the same constraint. We're just reporting it and showing it that it is actually important. There is a second one that we propose in this work where we're saying the goodware and malware in the training and testing dataset must be drawn from the same time frame. Otherwise, the classifier might just pick up some artifact. So I understand that once you roll out this, when you spell out this constraint, it seems obvious, but I believe that we have been neglecting this problem, at least in the academic community, for quite some time. Now let's move on to spatial bias. And here is quite interesting, because now it comes the moment where you want to test your classifier. Okay? And again, we are in a binary classification setting. And usually, we're working with imbalanced data set. Okay? So there is one class that is much smaller than the other class. And you can see when you read papers that people use different ratio of the testing data set. So sometimes people use 1-to-1, even if in real life the problem is imbalanced. Sometimes they use 1-to-50, 50-to-1, and so forth and so on. And of course, you know, this would yield different results. And you see that results are all very good, otherwise the paper wouldn't be published, right? And but the question is this a realistic result? Well, we have to be very careful, because we cannot really modify the distribution, the ratio between, in this case, goodware and malware, in the testing data set, because that represents real life. That represents what you actually be observing in realistic situation. So what we need to understand, what is the real distribution or ratio between goodware and malware in a specific context, in this case, in Android security. And there are a couple of interesting work that we cite in our paper. And so roughly, there are different sources, and then we average that. And roughly, in the Android ecosystem, the majority of the apps that we observe are benign. And only a small percentage are considered as malware, and that is the 10%. But if you can see that, if you inflate that number, you get inflated result. So if you look at the plot in the slide, you can see on the x-axis the different testing set ratio, where on the left-hand side, on the left-hand side, you have all 100-to-1 benign, and on the right-hand side, you have the opposite. So you have one benign to 100 malware. And in that case, of course, you know, you're inflated the result, because if you look, for instance, at again, the precision or F1 score, which is the harmonic of precision recall, so the blue line or the yellow line, you can see they're actually increasing. But that result is inflated, because if you consider precision, it's just defined as a true positive over true positive plus false positives. In this case, the positive class is malware, so false positives are benign. They are mistakenly classified as malware. But if you're not injecting more benign into your testing data set, but you're just increasing the number of malware, well, of course, you know, the precision will actually increase. But this is an artifact. This is an inflated result because of biased evaluation, because of this spatial bias evaluation. So it is clear that the testing distribution shouldn't be changed, because that should be representative of real life. Can we do the same? Can we do the same reasoning for the training data set? Can we change the ratio of objects that we have in the different classes in the training data set? Well, the answer is that yes, that's a fair game, because it's just us that we would like to train the classifier to be more sensitive or not towards one class or the other. Of course, we have to understand the implication of throwing more malware or more benign in this training process. And we come up with an empirical algorithm, and we call the tuning algorithm, that basically helps to tune the ratio in the training data set between these two classes to reach a sort of a plateau, a sweet spot, where you try to maximize the performance of the algorithms over time without retraining. So we just try to delay slightly the time decay, although this will still happen. And empirically, the sweet spot is between the percentage of malware in the testing data set and 50%. 50% because if you push forward, then you flip the problem. And then the malware moves from becoming the minority class, the majority class. And then, you have the problem on the other side. And you can see in this plot, they're quite dense, I understand. So let's not look at all the lines, but just look at the intersection of the lines. And that is the sweet spot that you can get by running the algorithm. And basically, you can see that this varies, and it depends on the algorithm, on the ML algorithm that you are evaluating at this stage. So to sum up, we have temporal constraint, so that try to enforce temporal causality, that all the training objects must be temporally anterior to all testing objects, and goodware and malware should be drawn in the training testing dataset from the same time frame. But also we have the spatial constraint that to guarantee realistic evaluation, then we have to have a truthful malware to goodware ratio in testing, in the testing data set. We can play with the training, but we need to understand what are the implications. So here, just to get to the conclusion, I want to show you, once we know, once we enforce this policy, and we actually show how an algorithm performance decay over time, it will be interesting to actually summarize this decay with a number. And this number is obtained by a metric that we introduce, we call the area under the time of a given performance that you are interested. So if you look at this, at the plot, and let's pick the blue line, which is F1 score, we can actually look at the dashed part below that line, and that represents the area under the curve. So in that case, for algorithm one that we trained on the year before, the AUT of the F1 score for the next 2 years is the number 0.58. For the second algorithm is the number 0.32. So despite the fact that in a k-fold cross-validation, algorithm two has a much higher performance result, if you look actually in realistic situation, as the time progresses and decay kicks in, we'll see that actually algorithm one is a little bit more resistant to time decay, okay? And of course, you know, we expanded the work to try to understand, okay, how about deep learning? Because there was kind of, you know, the missing piece. And with deep learning, we can see that we have even a higher area under the time of the F1 score, if you look at the rightmost plot, which is 0.64, although the k-fold cross-validation for that algorithm is the lowest among the other two. Okay? There are other implications here, of course, you know, you need to consider the amount of data that you need to train your classifier, and of course, you know, the ability to explain why classification happened. But you can see that, you know, with this number and this constraint, you have a fair evaluation. You can actually now evaluate different strategies to slow down and to address time decay. And of course, you know, there's a lot more consideration on this plot, but I'm running out of time, so I just wanted to wrap it up. So as a conclusion, I believe that we should stop seeing machine learning as a black magic tool, and we should actually try to understand a little bit more what are the implications of using machine learning algorithm in a context where we are playing with non-stationarity. And I'm not advocating we shouldn't be using k-fold cross-validation. We should be using k-fold cross-validation because there is a purpose for it, so to hinder, for instance, overfitting. But then we have to promote a sound evaluation in security context as time progresses, because this is where we're going to be applying our algorithms. To this, we define a couple of constraints that work on the temporal and the spatial domain. And we also propose a metric that captures this decay over time with a number. And we released TESSERACT, which is the study, as an open source tool, which is scikit-learn compatible, to promote sound evaluation of machine learning for security in this context. And there are more details at the link here in the slide, STOLAB-KCLSC UK project TESSERACT. And I thank you very much for the attention. I'll be happy to take any more questions.